YouTube is live. No views.
Good evening, and welcome to our Shelter in the Power Crusade. My name is Michael Lewis, and I am your guide through this Shelter in the Power revival that's been going on this week. We're so thankful and we're so happy that you've decided to tune in with us tonight. And we have a very important message for you. That message is going to take a little bit longer than usual. So what we want to do tonight is go ahead and get into God's word immediately. And so we want to thank you for being on tonight. Let us have a word of prayer and let us get into the word of God tonight and let the Lord teach us about how to take care of our physical bodies. The topic of our message tonight is, are you in Babylon? Are you in Babylon? Let us pray together. Lord, we just want to thank you so much for your mercy and your grace. Tonight's message is a message, Lord, that will affect our everyday lives. It will affect our existence. And so we pray for your Holy Spirit that you would teach us here tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. And we just want to thank you for coming, because we have a very special, important message tonight as it relates to Babylon. And so we're going to get into the message. Everything, as we say every night, comes from the Bible. It comes from God's word. And so let's get started. The truth about Babylon, let's talk about it. Here, there she is. This woman represents a church. Because in the book of Revelation, and particularly in the Bible, a woman represents a church. A pure woman represents God's pure church. And a harlot represents God's false church. It represents the church that is meeting together and preaching and praying, but they are not God's church. They are an apostate church. They've been set up to look like God's church, but they're not God's church. This woman holding that cup of wine represents false church. The symbol of spiritual apostasy. God's final three-point message of love and mercy is being taken to the entire world in our day. Revelation 14, 6 through 12, what is the second part of that message? Before I get into the second part of that message, let me tell you where that message came from. This message was what we call, in theological circles, a three angels message. Now, in actuality, in this chapter, there were seven angels that actually spoke. But the key messages of this chapter are called a three angels message. And what these three messages are, they are God's word to God's end time people. These are God's words to God's end time people to teach and to tell and to spread all over the world. These are messages that every person that's living on this earth will hear before the second coming of Jesus Christ. In other words, these messages are so important that every individual living on the earth needs to hear these messages. And it's so important that we're preaching to you in the midst of a global pandemic, because nothing can stop these three messages from going forth. Nothing can stop them. Nothing can stop them. So before I get to the second message, the first message says that the judgment is coming. The first message says that the judgment is coming, and because the judgment is coming, that those who live on this earth should worship God. That's the first message. Now here's the second message. The second message is Babylon is falling. The second message is Babylon is falling. And it says, what is God's command regarding Babylon, and to whom is it given? Revelation chapter 18, verse 4 says, come out of her, my people. Now let me give you an understanding of this concept of Babylon, because particularly in the book of Revelation, Babylon is figurative. Babylon is symbolic. Babylon represents those who are in a church and think that they're worshiping God, but what they are doing is diametrically opposed to God's word. Let me explain Babylon. Babylon, the word, comes from the Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament. And Babylon was started by a character, a biblical character called Nimrod. And Nimrod came up from modern-day Ethiopia, and he came to the Mesopotamia area. And in this area, he started several cities. And he was a great warrior and a mighty hunter before the Lord. And as a matter of fact, Nimrod was such a mythic figure in the historical world, not only is he documented in the Bible, he's also documented in other literary works of that particular time, called the Epic of Gilgamesh and other documents. As a matter of fact, this particular figure, his name may be called something different in the different documents, but they're still speaking about the same person. And so what Nimrod did is Nimrod decided to build a tower that was so high, if there was ever a biblical flood again, they would be able to withstand the flood because they'd have a tower high enough to reach above it. And so they wanted to gather to, they wanted to gather together, and they wanted to come together, and they wanted to make sure that they protected themselves from Almighty God. They wanted to make sure that they could have a world outside of the world that God wanted to create, because God had given them a command, and the command was that they were supposed to scatter and fill the earth after Noah landed the ark. But they didn't want to scatter. They wanted to gather together in defiance of the word of God. And so they built a tower, or they attempted to. And what God did, as God does, he came down and he looked at what they were doing. And what God did is he didn't kill one single person. What he did was he made sure that they weren't able to complete their project because he confused their languages. He confused their languages so that brick mason couldn't talk to the painter, and the painter couldn't talk to the architect, and the architect couldn't talk to the sculptor. And because they couldn't communicate with each other, what happened is, instead of them staying together trying to complete the tower, they ended up scattering as God told them to do. And here's what I want to let you know, that when God tells you to do something and you do the opposite of what God tells you to do, often God will bring confusion in your life in order to get you to do what he originally told you to do. And that's what he did. He brought confusion among them so that they would scatter instead of the gathering that they were doing. And so now that their languages are confused and that they were scattered, what God, that the word Babylon from then, from that point to now, it means confusion. And so whenever Babylon is called out in the book of Revelation, it represents a confused church with confused people teaching confusing doctrines. Babylon is a confused church with confused people teaching confusing doctrines. Well, you might say, well, what are we talking about? Well, what does Santa Claus have to do with the birth of the Lord Jesus? That's confusion. What does Easter bunnies and Easter eggs have to do with the resurrection of Jesus? Babylon is when you mix pagan practices in with biblical doctrine. It's when you take what is common and try to place it with something that's divine. And what God is saying is, if you are in one of those confusing churches, if you are one of those confused people, if you are being taught confusing doctrines and you know it, God says the command is to come out of her. Come out of those places. Now, part of Babylon is dealing with your soul temple, your body. And so God tonight, when he frees you spiritually, he also wants you to know that you ought to be physically healthy. What diet has the Lord pronounced to be good for man? And then God said, behold, I have given you every seed-bearing plant on the face of all the earth, and every tree whose fruit contains seed. They will be yours for food. God first gave humanity fruit and vegetables to eat. That was the diet that God had given humanity to eat. He says, do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. This body that God has given you, it doesn't belong to you. You are a steward of that body, and God desires that you protect this body, that you care for it, and you only put in your body things that will give it health and give it strength. And when you destroy the body, God will destroy that soul. The Bible says, if any man defile the temple of God, that God shall destroy him, for he that destroys the temple is destroys himself, for which temple ye are. Beloved, I pray that in every way that you may prosper and enjoy good health, as your soul also prospers. In other words, God desires for your body to be strong. He desires for your physical life to be prosperous. And one of the ways that he wants you to be prosperous physically is for you to put healthful and good things inside your body. Now I know you're feeling a little bit nervous right now, because I'm about to get into your kitchen and get into your pots and pans. But the Lord God, if he is going to change you and make you like him, he has to get into every part of your life. There is no room of your life that God cannot be a part of. And certainly your religion, your spirituality, that has something to do with what you put in your body. God says he wants you to prosper and be in good health, just as your soul prospers. In other words, he wants you to be spiritually prosperous and also physically prosperous. Okay, so it says, so whatever you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. In other words, whatever you do, whether you even if you eat or drink, everything that the believer does must be done to the glory of God. Okay, let's talk about what we should eat and what we shouldn't eat. Let's talk what the Bible says about that. I know we're not talking about whether this is gonna lead to salvation or not. We're talking about what's helpful for the body according to the Bible. The Bible says, also the swine is unclean for you because it has cloven hooves, yet does not chew the cud. You shall not eat their flesh or touch their dead carcasses. Now, here's what God did. In ancient times, God had certain animals on land, certain animals in water, certain animals that flew that were clean for humanity to eat, which means they could nourish the body the way that God knew the body needed to be nourished. But there were also some animals that were unclean. These were animals that were set aside for a different purpose. And God commanded humanity through his word not to eat those animals. And the swine, the pig, the pork is one of those animals that God said that you shouldn't eat. Now here's how God makes the difference. If there's a land animal, that land animal has to chew cud, and that land animal has to have a divided hoof. So if it doesn't have a cloven hoof and chew the cud, that both of them, it is unclean for you to eat. And so even though the pig has the cloven hoof, the pig doesn't chew the cud. So the Bible says that the swine is unclean for the human being. Deuteronomy 14, verses 7 and 8. And God continues this with other land animals. And so if you want to know what land animals are clean animals, You can look at that animal, you can observe that animal, and if that animal had the cloven hoof and that animal chewed the cud, a person could know that that animal was clean for the human being to eat. They could know that. Look at him, there he is. America loves him. And right now, there is the food chain of America is in jeopardy because America loves that pig. America loves this animal. God said not to eat that. God said don't deal with that. But America is eating huge quantities of pigs. There's an whole industry out there for that animal. Look at it. Look at it. Look at it. You see, what's unclean about this animal is it has trichinae larvae, and it can cause what doctors call trichinosis, which is worms, which is unclean worms in the digestive tract, because the animal is unclean, and whatever an animal eats, and you eat the animal, you have eaten what that animal has eaten, because they were right when they told us you are what you eat. Now let me do a scenario here to help you to understand the concept that you are what you eat. Okay, are you ready? Let's go through it. A fly is eaten by a frog. Are you with me? If you're with me, say amen, even though I can't hear you. All right. A snake eats that frog that ate that fly. Okay, are you with me? And the pig eats the snake that ate the frog that ate the fly. Are you with me? Now here we go. Now, you eat the pig that ate the snake that ate the frog that ate the fly. So when you had your bacon, you not only had a bacon sandwich, you had a snake sandwich, a frog sandwich, and a fly sandwich. Because you truly are what you eat. There it is. A cup of, a glass of beer and a pork chop. That's the diet of America. There it is. Here's what the Bible says. The Bible says, touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. God gave us not only our bodies, God gave humanity this entire earth. And many people are now concerned that the earth is being destroyed through this thing that they call climate change. And simply, climate change is an accumulation of so-called modernity, so-called progress, that is destroying the natural habitat of the animals that God has created. And because we want our fast food, and because we want our cell phones, and because we want our modern technology and modern conveniences, we are willing as human beings to destroy this earth in order to have the level of convenience that we desire. So we are both destroying the planet, and because of our diets, we are destroying ourselves. God says, if you destroy the temple, which is this body, him, God, will destroy. Here's what it said. Here's the word of God. Here's the word of God. I have to read it. It says, behold, the Lord will come with fire and with his chariots like a whirlwind, to render his anger with fury and his rebuke with flames of fire. They that sanctify themselves and purify themselves in the gardens behind the one tree in the midst, eating swine's flesh and the abomination and the mouse, shall be consumed together, saith the Lord. God says that he will destroy those who destroy this temple. Now you might be saying, well, what are you talking about? Is God just going to throw lightning bolts on people? Boom, as soon as I eat the bed, I've eaten it all my life and nothing's ever happened to me. Let me tell you something. All of the heart disease, all of the strokes, all of the cancers, all of these different physical maladies that happen to humanity are in large part because of the unhealthy diet that we as modern humans are consuming. And so because we've been disobedient in what we are eating and what we are putting into our bodies, we are reaping what we are sowing as it relates to our physical health. And many of the modern diseases that we have today can be traced back to our lifestyle. Yes, sir. And if we improve our lifestyle, we will have a better chance of avoiding some of those diseases. Now, let me just be honest with you. You can do all that you can do, but you still might get something. But what you can do is to make sure that you do everything you can to make sure that you're healthy. So that's what God says. Now, we're not done yet. Look at it. It's there in the supermarket. People, you got to go get it. You running to go get it. Look at it. Look at that. Look at the mouth. In some places, that's a delicacy. Some places, that's a delicacy. Now they say that this coronavirus came through animals. It came through bats. Well, we know from scripture that a bat is an unclean animal. Mm-hmm. We know it's an unclean animal. So if what they're saying is correct, that it came from bats, we know that if humans had never started to consume a bat, then that would be something, this virus might be something that we wouldn't have to deal with. Now, that's only true if it came from what it said it came from. I don't know. I'm just a preacher. I wouldn't know that information. Okay? Okay. Well, here's the cow. Here's the cow. So let me give you a quiz. Can you eat the cow? Well, a cow chews cud and has a cloven hoof. So yes, you can have your hamburger. A cow is considered a clean animal. Amen. You can have your cow. You can have your beef steak. You can have your beef. Bad for him, but he's legal to eat according to the scriptures. Now we've dealt with the animals on the land. Let's deal with the animals in the waters. Now here's what the Bible says. It says, these you may eat of all that are in the water, wherever in the water has fins and scales, whether in the seas or in the river, that you may eat. Now, so if somebody's fishing in ancient times, and they wanted to know whether a fish or a seafood was good to eat, all they had to do was follow this instruction from the scriptures. So now that we've got this, and it's right here on the screen, let's give ourselves a little quiz. Can I eat a bass? Well, a bass has fins and scales. Can I eat a brim? A brim has fins and scales. Well, can I eat a catfish? Can I? Is it allowable? It has skin instead of scales. And so because it doesn't have fins and scales, catfish are not allowed according to the scriptures. Can I eat lobster? Doesn't have fins or scales. Can I eat shrimp? Doesn't have fins or scales. Can I eat oysters? Doesn't have fins or scales. All of those animals are unlawful for the human being to eat because they go against the biblical injunction of fins and scales for those animals that live in the waters. I know some of you all want to drop out the live stream now, but you ought to stick with us, because if you follow what the Lord says, it'll be good for you. In 1988, 3,000 Chinese in Shanghai developed hepatitis A from what? From clams. And these, now let's go. Now we've gone through what animals are in the land that are unclean, and animals in the water that are unclean. Let's now go to the birds in the air that are unclean. And here's what the Bible says in Leviticus 11: and these you shall regard as an abomination among the birds. They shall not be eaten. They are an abomination. The eagle, the vulture, and the buzzard. These animals are unclean. And And the reason why they're unclean is because they are scavengers. They primarily eat dead carcasses of animals. They are scavengers. And God says, don't eat those birds that are primarily scavengers. Now, when archaeologists pulled up and unearthed mummies and did research on their bones, they found that many of the mummies many of the mummies had signs of these diseases in their bones. Heart disease and obesity and cancer and tooth decay and stress. Why? Because the Egyptians subsisted on a diet that was unclean, and they got these diseases because of the Egyptian lifestyle. Here's what the Lord said to his people. He says, if you diligently heed to the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight, give ear to his commandments and keep all his statutes. Here's what he says. Look at what the Lord says. He says, I will put none of the diseases on you which I have brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. And so God is saying, if you don't eat the things I didn't tell you to eat, if God says, if you just live according to my word, all of the diseases of the Egyptians will avoid you because you have listened to my word. Exodus 15, 26. Diet. Diet. We must have a balanced diet. See, the things on the lower part of the triangle are the things that we should eat. And as you go up, you look at the things at the bottom, you see the fruits and the vegetables and the whole grains and the good oils and the good fats. Those are the things we should eat. And as you get to the higher part of the triangle, those are things that you should have some of them, but you should have a little bit less of it. But we love to cook and we love to eat. Now let's talk about alcohol. Now I know in the pandemic, people have wanted to get them a little nip of something to take the edge off. So what does the Bible say about alcohol? Well, here's what the Bible says. The Bible says wine is a mocker. Strong drink is a brawler. And whoever is led astray by it is not wise. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 1. Now, when the Bible talks about wine, the Bible uses this word, this Greek word called oinos, and in Greek, and yayin in Hebrew. And how do you know whether it is talking about fermented wine, which is alcoholic wine, or unfermented wine, which is grape juice? How do you know whether it's talking about one or the other? Well, you have to read the context of the text to make a determination of whether it was unfermented or it was fermented. God never intended for us to drink fermented wine, and it is not allowable to drink fermented wine even in communion, because God would never put as symbolic of his blood fermented wine, because fermented wine would cloud your mind and cloud your thinking and lower your inhibitions, and God would never put something that would cloud the human mind as a symbol for his blood. So all those churches drinking real wine for communion, you've missed the symbolism and you've missed the figure. God would never put a symbol that would cause the mind to be beclouded as a symbol for his blood, because you must choose God with a clear mind and a clear heart. So wine is a mocker. Alcohol is deceptive. 2 out of 5 people who begin drinking have serious problems. And there's many people that during this pandemic have been sipping a little bit too much. And God wants to say to you tonight, you need to back off that alcohol. You need to put the Ciroc down. You need to put the Michelob aside. It's injurious to your health, and you need to put it aside. He says, look not upon the wine when it is red, when it giveth its color in the cup, when it moveth itself aright. At the last, it biteth like a serpent and sting like an adder. Thine eyes shall behold strange women. When the text says it biteth like a serpent and stingeth like an adder, that's that big old hangover that you have that next morning when your hair be biting like several snakes got into you. I remember I was in the barbershop one day, and you know, when men get going to the barbershop, they start telling fish stories. So I was in the barbershop one day getting a haircut, and one young man was there, and he was talking about his night at the club. And he said he got there about 10 o'clock, and he couldn't really hook up with anybody that he felt like was on his level. So he sat at the bar and he began to drink, and a female began to chat him up, but he didn't feel like that she was on his level. In his estimation, she was about a 3 out of 10. Now that was what he said. All of God's children are beautiful, but that's what he said. So he said he kept on drinking and kept on chatting it up and chopping it up with the young lady, and said, well, about 12 o'clock, she went from looking like a 3 to looking like a 6. And as he kept on drinking and kept on drinking, about 2 in the morning, she went from being a 6 to an 8. And about 7 o'clock in the morning, he found himself in the bed with this particular young lady. And when he woke up, he had a headache and she was a 3 again. You see, alcohol doesn't make you do anything, but it lowers your inhibitions. It lowers the boundaries that you set, that you would cross over and do things that you would not normally do if you were sober. And so the Bible warns his children, he warns humanity about alcohol, because alcohol lowers your ambitions and causes you to cross boundaries that when you're sober and you're thinking, you wouldn't cross. You know, you can't say blaming on the liquor. The liquor didn't make you do it, but the liquor reduced your inhibitions. It took away your boundaries and caused you to do things that you would not have normally done. You see, when you have that liquor, now I don't want to just be on the young men, young women, you all can imbibe in liquor also and look on strange men. Yes, you can. So I want to make sure that I'm gender neutral as it relates to people getting drunk and doing stupid and silly things. You can do that too. And so when you drink liquor and you invite drunkenness, you cause yourself to do things you wouldn't normally do. So the Bible says, in order not to put yourself in that position, you should abstain from alcohol. You should abstain. The Bible uses the word wine to refer to distinctly different grape beverages, one unfermented and the other fermented, and we spoke about determining that based upon the context of the Bible text that you're reading. The Hebrew word yayin in the Old Testament and in the Greek word oinos in the New Testament can mean either the fresh, unfermented juice of the grape or the fermented, intoxicating drink that God says you ought to stay away from. But America loves their alcohol. America loves their bars. America loves its clubs. And alcohol is a main component of every bar, of every club, of many of our social situations. Alcohol is a part of it. But here's what alcoholism can do. Alcoholism can wreak havoc on a person's liver. It can wreak havoc on a person's body. And here's the question: what will she do? You see, alcohol is a temptation for many people. And just like the fruit was a temptation to Eve, alcohol is a temptation to many people. And the question is tonight, what will you do? That's the question. For some people, it's not alcohol. For some people, it's other things. Let's keep on moving. You see, Jesus faced Satan's temptations head on. Jesus faced all of Satan's temptations. He didn't run from them, but what he did was, is he used this three-word phrase. He used this phrase. He simply said, "It is written," and he gave the devil God's instructions through his word. And you can face Satan's temptations too in the power of God. Well, let's get to tobacco. Let's get to nicotine. Let's also get to marijuana. Let's also get to weed. Smoking affects not only your health, but the health of your loved ones. Do you know what you're smoking? See, remember that old school Surgeon General's warning that nobody ever listens to? Cigarettes are addictive for human beings. Cigarettes are bad for your health. As a matter of fact, cigarettes, nicotine, is so bad for humanity, almost no public building will allow you to go in and smoke. It's universally accepted that nicotine is bad for health. And not only is regular cigarettes bad for health, but now they discover that vaping is just as bad as cigarettes. Now, some people say, well, I smoke marijuana, it's natural, so it must be good for me. Now, I don't smoke marijuana, and I don't think anybody else should. But let me say this. I can guarantee you that that is not helpful for the human body to smoke something. It is not helpful, it is not healthy for the human person to smoke nicotine, to smoke marijuana, to smoke tobacco. Smoking as a medium of putting a substance in your body is not helpful in any form and in any way. The human body was not created for you to pull smoke into the body to put a drug inside of you. It's not helpful. It's not helpful. Cigarettes cost too much money and cause too many health problems. And cigarettes break the commandment of God. The Bible says, "Thou shalt not kill." In other words, you shouldn't kill anybody else, and you shouldn't kill yourself. You shouldn't kill yourself fast, and you shouldn't kill yourself slow. God says that you can kill, you can commit murder in 3 minutes, or you can commit it over 30 years. And smoking cigarettes is committing slow murder. Is committing slow murder. You might be saying, well, you know, I smoke marijuana because of pain or other things. That might be a legitimate utilitarian purpose. But those of you who are out there smoking marijuana for recreational purposes, you need to understand that it has a deleterious effect on your brain. And no matter what studies that you're reading that speak opposite of that, you must understand that when you smoke something into the body, it is unhealthy to the body to smoke something inside of you, into your lungs. It is unhealthy. Here is what cigarette smoke contributes to. It contributes to heart disease. It contributes to smoke strokes. It contributes to cancer, emphysema, premature births, poor circulation, and shortness of breath. It contributes to pre-existing conditions that cause you to be eligible to get other diseases because your system is reduced, is diminished by smoking. But you can overcome smoking. Here's how you can do it. You can make a decision to stop. You can seek God for strength to stand firm in your decision. You can drink plenty of water because as you drink plenty of water, it flushes out the system. And you can be willing to suffer for Christ's sake. It's not going to be easy to overcome cigarettes. It's not going to be easy to overcome alcohol. I'm not going to tell you tonight that getting over your habits is going to be easy. But what I can tell you, that you can do all things through Christ who gives you strength. Stand firm on the word of God. 1 Peter 4, 1 through 2, and James 4, 6 through 8. You can overcome smoking. You can overcome it. You can get the best of it. You can be an overcomer. I can do all things through Christ. Philippians 4, 13. You see, I love this quote. Free cheese is always available in mousetraps. See, that thing what you think is good for you, see, just because it's good to you does not mean it's good for you. Just because it tastes good doesn't mean it's good for you. Now, you've heard me speak about food tonight, and you might be saying, well, I like oysters, I like lobster, I like bacon, I like, if these things taste good, and these things are on this earth, why, if I can't eat them, for what purpose were they put on earth for? Because God said everything was good. So if everything is good, and the pig is on this earth, and the clam is on this earth, and the oyster is on this earth, and the lobster is on this earth, and it all tastes good, and it's a delicacy, and I love going to the restaurant and getting it, if it's on this earth, and if it's good, and you say I can't eat it, why was it put on this earth? You better explain that to me, or I don't accept anything you said to me this evening. Let me tell you. Everything God made is good, but it's good for the purpose that God made it. And God made trash collectors and refuse collectors on land, on sea, and in the air. In ancient times, the garbage truck didn't come around and pick up everybody's trash on a particular day of the week. In ancient times, there was no trash service. God made certain animals to be natural garbage collectors on land, natural garbage collectors in the waters, and natural garbage collectors in the air. And for this purpose, these animals are very good at it. And when you partake of these animals, it's like jumping in the garbage can and having a meal. And God did not intend for you to do that. Free cheese is always available in mousetraps. Well, not only do we have to worry about smoking and these things, but there are also stimulants that reduce and diminish our capacity. And coffee and tea is one of those things. Why? Because what it does is it gives us an artificial rush. But the crash that we experience after the rush can be quite debilitating. Caffeine, coffee contains a poison. Caffeine, tea has caffeine. One person said, we are a nation of tea and coffee drunkards. In other words, we have to have it. Why? Because we have to get going in the morning because we don't get enough B vitamins. And so we use artificial stimulants to get ourselves going. And let's not forget. So now we deal with the coffee and tea. But now let's deal with the prescription medication. There is a place for prescription medication. And if it's prescribed by a doctor, you need to take it. But there is also abuse of legal prescription medication. And we need to make sure that if the prescription was not made, was not prescribed for us particularly and individually, then we need to stay away from it. If the doctor says take one pill a day, that's what we should take. We should stick to our medical professionals' instructions on prescription medication, and we should not abuse prescription medication. It is a huge issue in our country. The abuse of opioids. It is as abusive, it is as a scourge as illegal drugs. Many people are shooting up both legal and illegal drugs for an artificial high in order to make it through life. But Christ can set you free. I know tonight I've spoken about a lot of very difficult things, but I preach this because, as we said on the first night, we are not trying to bring God down to our level. It is our desire, in order for us to be lift up humanity to God's standard. Our desire is not to bring God's standard down. Our desire is to lift humanity's standards back where God made it and called it to be. And so many of you now, even though you are trepidatious about what you've heard tonight, your heart is saying, I need to do that. That's for me. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but it's for me. And so tonight, as we did last night, if you just want to make sure that whatever you put in your body, that whatever you put in this temple that God gave you, that you want it to be righteous and pure according to his word, we're starting a virtual church. And we want you to be a part of that virtual church. And all of us that are going to be a part of this virtual church, we are going to commit ourselves to treating our bodies like a temple. So if you want to be a part of that church tonight, if you want to be a part of the group of believers that keep God's Sabbath, if you want to be a part of the group of believers that believes and keep God's law, if you want to be part of those believers that takes care of their soul temple and their soul body, just write in the comment section, I want to follow. Just write in the comment section, I want to follow, signifying you want to be a part of this virtual church. And then you need to text your Bible worker and let them know, I want to be a part. I want to follow. In the comments section, I want to follow. Text your worker. Text your Bible instructor. I want to follow. That you want to be a part of this virtual church. A virtual church that does not do simply what the world says to do. We don't do just what society tells us we have to do. We do what the Bible says do, because the Lord knows what's best. You want to be a part of that virtual church. You want to be a part of God's remnant church. Just put in the comment section, I want to follow. Just text your worker, I want to follow. Text your Bible worker, I want. Do both of them. Do both of them to make your decision clear. And God will bless you. God will certainly bless you. We want to thank you so much for being online with us tonight. Tomorrow we have a very important message. That message tomorrow is, what happens 1 nanosecond after you die? What happens 1 nanosecond after you die? I want to thank you for being in the shelter, in the power, revival. We know that God is blessing you. If God is blessing you and you've been blessed throughout this week, just put in the comment section that you've been blessed, that you have been uplifted to God, and that you've been spiritually blessed. Won't you do that for us? Give us some encouragement that the Lord is truly blessing his people as the word of God comes forth. Let us pray tonight. Lord, we just thank you so much for your mercy and your grace. We thank you and we bless you. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen. May God bless you.